الحمد لله رب العالمين نحمده سبحانه وتعالى حمدا كثيرا طيبا طاهرا دائما مباركا فيه ملء السماوات وملء الأرض وملء ما بينهما وملء ما شئت يا ربنا من شيء بعد أهل الثناء والمجد أحق ما قال العبد وكلنا لك عبد اللهم لا مانع لما أعطيت ولا معطي لما منعت ولا ينفع ذا الجد منك الجد لك العتبى حتى ترضى ولا حول ولا قوة لنا إلا بك وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبد الله ورسوله وصفيه من خلقه وحبيبه بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة وكشف الغمة وجاهد في الله حق الجهاد حتى أتاه اليقين اللهم صل وسلم وزد وبارك على الحبيب المصطفى محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه وأتباعه ومن اهتدى بهديه وعمل بسنته إلى يوم الدين وارض اللهم عنا معهم بفضلك وكرمك يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم آمين. I praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the creator of heavens and earth, the provider, the bestower, the source of bounties and blessings. I thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for guiding us to his path. I thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for making us among the followers of Muhammad and those who walk in the footsteps of Muhammad. I bear witness that there is no deity worthy of worship save Allah, and I bear witness that Muhammad is Allah's final prophet and messenger, the bearer of glad tidings, the carrier of the torch of light, the role model to be followed, the beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I ask Allah to make us among the followers of Muhammad and to give us the strength to walk in the footsteps of Muhammad. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as we've loved the Prophet in the life of this world, to be granted an opportunity to enter Jannah in his company. I ask Allah to extend his blessings and love and grace to the Prophet and his family, his descendants and companions and their followers, and all the righteous men and women. And I ask Allah for us, each and every one of us and our loved ones, to be included among them. Allahumma ameen. My dear brothers and sisters, I greet you with the greeting of Islam. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I wanted to say Eid Mubarak to each and every one of you. Eid al-Adha is right around the corner. The blessed month of Dhul-Hijjah has already started. Many of our brothers and sisters, our beloved family members, are already performing. They have embarked upon the journey of Hajj. Many of the Hajjis are now arriving in the sacred sites of Islam in Mecca, some in Medina as well. Those of you who have been blessed with the journey of Hajj before, I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to have accepted your ibadah. And those of you who have not performed Hajj, I ask Allah to grant you the opportunity to visit the sacred sites of Islam and to fulfill this sacred religious obligation sooner than later. Allahumma ameen. It is astounding when you realize that most Muslims will live and die without performing Hajj. There is close to 2 billion Muslims now, about 1.8. And if the average number of people that actually performs Hajj every year is about 4 to 5 million. If you actually do the math, let's assume that the average person will live 100 years, which is impossible, right? But if you do the math, in your lifetime, if you're going to live 100 years, if you do the math, 5 million a year multiplied by 100, that's 500 million, right? Which is about one quarter of the Muslims. So in one lifetime, for an entire generation, only one quarter of all Muslims that live on this earth will be actually granted a chance to visit the sacred sites and perform Hajj. And if you realize that there's a lot of redundancy, you know, a lot of people actually perform Hajj multiple times, so the numbers are actually lower than one quarter. If you are included in that group of Muslims that in their lifetime they're able to perform Hajj once, you are blessed. Because three quarters of the Muslims will live and die without having the financial means or the religious means or the commitment or the motivation to actually perform Hajj. And that's why I pray on the beautiful days of Dhul-Hijjah, I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for those of us who have performed Hajj, for their Hajj to be accepted. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for those of us who have not, I pray to Allah Azza wa Jal to grant you an opportunity and to send you an invitation to come to His house soon. Ameen. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for our brothers and sisters that are performing Hajj to return home to their families and to their loved ones safe and sound, having performed this beautiful act of worship. Allahumma ameen. A lot of beautiful parallels when you think about it between Dhul Hijjah and the month of Ramadan. When we talk about the 10 days of Dhul Hijjah, it is almost like we're talking about 10 days in the month of Ramadan. In fact, the scholars have always argued back and forth, which are the more blessed days of the year? Is it the days of Ramadan or is it the days of Dhul Hijjah? And I wanted to take this opportunity to compare and contrast Dhul Hijjah and Ramadan to show you how close and similar those months are. The only difference is that we are not required to fast in the month of Dhul Hijjah. Had we been required to fast in Dhul Hijjah, the spirit of Dhul Hijjah would have been no different from the spirit of the beautiful month of Ramadan. And let's actually examine it very quickly. In Ramadan we fast, and yes, it is true in Dhul Hijjah we are not required to fast, but we are encouraged to fast. As one of the acts of worship that we are encouraged to do. A lot of people, you know, it is actually reported that sometimes the Prophet ﷺ fasted all 9 days. You cannot fast the 10th day, right? Why? Because the 10th day is actually the day of Eid. And it is haram to fast on the day of Eid. But it is actually has been reported that multiple times in his life, the Prophet ﷺ actually fasted all 9 days. The first 9 days of Dhul Hijjah, right? If you don't fast the 9 days of Dhul Hijjah, maybe you can fast Mondays and Thursdays. You know, it'll just be one Monday and one Thursday in those 9 days. If you cannot do that, then at least fast on which day? Fast on the day of Arafah, which is the 9th day of Dhul Hijjah. This year, inshallah, it's going to be Saturday, right? Saturday, the 10th of August. So you remember that in Ramadan we fast, and in the month of Dhul Hijjah, we are encouraged to fast as well. You know, so fasting, check. In Ramadan, we are encouraged to focus on our daily prayers, to pray extra, to do our sunnahs, and to pray tahajjud and qiyam as well, right? To stand up at night in prayer. It is also the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ that in the month of Dhul Hijjah, as part of your acts of worship, that you try and focus on your salah in the month of Dhul Hijjah as well, right? Your 5 daily prayers, if you are on and off, this is a chance for you to pray regularly, right? If you don't do your sunnah, this is a chance for you to start learning how to pray sunnah before and after your acts of worship, right? If you are not in the business of praying tahajjud whatsoever, then perhaps it is an opportunity for you in the month of Dhul Hijjah to learn the art of praying tahajjud, of getting up at night in order to pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? So, salah, check. Similarities between Ramadan and the month of Dhul Hijjah. What about charity? In Ramadan, we are encouraged to give and give and give as much as possible. In fact, most people dedicate their zakah in the month of Ramadan. In the month of Ramadan, we are required to give zakatul fitr, right? This is a huge similarity. Now, in the same vein, if you look at the month of Dhul Hijjah, what are we required to give towards the end of the 10 days? Another act of charity, which is your udhiya, your sacrifice. So zakatul fitr, at the end of the last 10 days of Ramadan, we give it. And we do our sacrifice at the end of the last 10 days of Dhul Hijjah. Subhanallah. Same exact thing. It's an act of communal charity in which we share the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as we celebrate. We share those blessings with others. So you are encouraged in the month of Dhul Hijjah to be in the spirit of giving. To be in the spirit of giving. You know, our teachers always taught us this. In the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah, invite people to your home at least once. Because it's an act of hospitality and sharing the blessings with others. If there is an iftar at the masjid and people are fasting, make sure that you attend that iftar. If you have pledges to fulfill, donations to make, make those in the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah. You see the similarities, right? So, sadaqah, charity, check. The Quran, and this is one of my most favorite things. When was the Quran first revealed? It was revealed in the last 10 days of Ramadan. Everyone knows that. In fact, the Quran clearly states, شَهْرُ رَمَضَانَ الَّذِي أُنزِلَ فِيهِ الْقُرْآنِ. This is what gave Ramadan its sanctity. It's what gave Ramadan its greatness. It is the fact that it is the month in which the initial verses of the Quran were revealed. A Jewish man once came to Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, and he said to him, يَا أَمِيرَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ آيَةٌ فِي كِتَابِكُمْ لَوْ أُنزِلَتْ عَلَيْنَا لَاتَّخَذْنَا يَوْمَهَا عِيدًا. There is a verse in your book. We have this non-Muslim Jewish man that lives in Medina under the rule of the Muslim state. And he goes to the Khalifa, to the head of state. And he goes to him and he says, Commander of the Faithful, you know, out of respect, it's like saying to the king, Your Majesty, right? Commander of the Faithful, there is a verse in your book. Had that verse been revealed to us, we would have taken the day as a day of celebration. So Umar ibn Khattab asked him, which verse is that? And he's the Muslim, and he's asking the Jewish man, which verse are you referring to? And the Jewish man refers to the verse from Surah Al-Ma'idah, Al-Yawma akmaltu lakum deenakum wa atmamtu alaykum ni'mati wa raditu lakum al-Islam deena. It is the ayah that was revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you know, on the day of Arafah, the very last year of his life sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, اليوم أكملت لكم دينكم. Today I have completed your deen. وأتممت عليكم نعمتي. And I have concluded my blessings upon you. ورضيت لكم الإسلام دينا. And I have accepted Islam as your way of life. In the order of the verses revealed in the Quran, this particular ayah comes last. The very last ayah of the Quran was revealed in the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah. So if the very first ayah of the Quran was revealed in the last 10 nights of Ramadan, the very last ayah of the Quran was revealed in the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah. See the similarities? Right? So Quran, check. At the very end of Ramadan, there is a celebration that we call Eid al-Fitr. And at the very end of the last of the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah, there is a celebration that we call Eid al-Adha. So Eid is also a similarity between those two beautiful seasons of forgiveness and love from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Right? Eid, check. The last 10 nights of Ramadan are characterized in the Sunnah to be days of what? Right? عِتْقٌ مِنَ النَّارِ in the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. Days in which we are liberated from the fire. We are forgiven. Aisha, when she asked the Prophet ﷺ, what do I say? What dua do I make in the last 10 nights of Ramadan? What does he tell her? Say, اللَّهُمَّ إِنَّكَ عَفُوٌ تُحِبُّ الْعَفْوَ فَعْفُ عَنِّي. Lord, you are the most forgiving and you love to forgive, so forgive me. So the last 10 nights or the last 10 days of Ramadan are days of forgiveness. What about the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah? They are days of what? They are days of Hidayah. وَلِتُكْمِلُوا الْعِدَّةَ وَلِتُكَبِّرُوا اللَّهَ عَلَى مَا هَدَاكُمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instructs the believers who are performing Hajj, complete the rituals of Hajj and remember Allah's name by way of gratitude in order to thank him for his guidance. And I will talk about this at length just a little bit later. So the last 10 days of Ramadan are days of forgiveness. The first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah are days of Hidayah. Qualifications, check. At the very end of the last 10 days of Ramadan, there is a public display of celebration. In fact, the entire month of Ramadan is a public display of our acts of worship. We fast very loudly and publicly. We have our iftar very loudly and publicly. And you hear news about Muslims, you know, having these massive dinners and these huge iftars all over the world, right? We celebrate. Salatul Taraweeh, done very publicly. And people come to the masajid, hustle and bustle. Everyone, millions of Muslims around the world experience the same beautiful thing. And at the end of the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah, there is also a massive public display of our acts of worship, which is Hajj. Same thing. Public displays of worship, check. My question is, the Prophet ﷺ still said, ما من أيام العمل الصالح أحب فيهن إلى الله عز وجل من هذه الأيام. There are no days in the year in which acts of worship are more beloved to Allah than which days? Ramadan or Dhul Hijjah? Dhul Hijjah. In other words, the Prophet ﷺ is still saying that the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah have more value in them than the days of Ramadan. Why? I will tell you why. Because in addition to everything I mentioned, all the similarities between Ramadan and Dhul Hijjah, brothers and sisters, Dhul Hijjah stands out with more value. Number one, the month of Ramadan is not one of the sacred months of the year, but Dhul Hijjah is. إِنَّ عِدَّةَ الشُّهُورِ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ 12 شَهْرًا فِي كِتَابِ اللَّهِ يَوْمَ خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ مِنْهَا أَرْبَعَةٌ حُرُمٌ فَلَا تَظْلِمُوا فِيهِنَّ أَنفُسَكُمْ. Allah says in the Quran, the count of the year in the judgment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is 12 months. And this has been ordained on the day He created heavens and earth, 4 of the 12 months shall be sacred. Months in which people should refrain from fighting and arguing and war, hurting each other, saying terrible things to each other, being judgmental to each other. You are required per the letter of the Quran to refrain from such activities in the 4 sacred months so that perhaps you will learn how to live a good and peaceful life for the rest of the year. Ramadan is a great month of worship and commitment and devotion to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but it is not one of the 4 sacred months of the year. Dhul Hijjah is. And for that, it stands out compared to the month of Ramadan. But it's not just that, brothers and sisters. At the very end of Ramadan, we celebrate Eid al-Fitr. How many days is Eid al-Fitr?
3.
How many days is Eid al-Adha?
4.
Eid al-Adha is 4 days. You know, which is good news for all the kids. You know, you celebrate for 4 days. Gift exchange for 4 days. Take time off from school and work for 4 days. Spend time with family for 4 days, right? There is more days of celebration for Eid al-Adha compared to Eid al-Fitr. It is the sunnah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He wanted us to be like this, right? But there is also something very, very different about Dhul Hijjah that we do not experience in Ramadan. In both months, we almost do all the acts of worship. You know, like I said earlier, fasting, sadaqah and zakah, charity, salah, all this. But there is one thing that we do in Dhul Hijjah that we do not do in Ramadan. And that is Hajj, obviously, right? We can fast in Dhul Hijjah, but we cannot perform Hajj in the month of Ramadan. And that is why the days of Dhul Hijjah stand out, brothers and sisters, compared to the month, the beautiful month of Ramadan. As important as Ramadan is, I still feel obligated to share with you the value of the 10 days of Dhul Hijjah, because this is a beautiful season that is often forgotten. In the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala clearly distinguishes Himself from all of His creation. You know, Christians say man was made in the image of God, right? Muslims say, لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ. We say that there is no equal to Allah. There's no parallel to Allah. Adam was not created in the image of God. God does not have a face and eyes and arms and legs like us. God does not have a beard. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not have the image of man. Man was not created in the image of God. Man is a mere creation of God, like He created anything and everything else. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in our minds should not occupy a particular image or physical space or a time frame. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is above and beyond our physical laws and our perception. If Jannah itself, fiha ma la aynun ra'at wa la udhunun sami'at wa la khatar ala qalbi bashar, as the Prophet taught us in the hadith, Jannah bears blessings that we've never seen, that we've never heard about, that never even occurred to us in our minds. We've never perceived of what happens in Jannah, which is a very accurate way of describing a domain that exists beyond the realm of man. If Jannah bears those qualities, then imagine the one that created Jannah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not bear qualities that you and I can understand, right? لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ. He has no equal. There is nothing similar to him. He is the omniscient, the omnipresent, and the omnipotent, subhanahu wa ta'ala. But a lot of people think that Allah is unique and different from us because He doesn't look like us, and that is true. But I want to expand the meaning just a little bit further. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not like us in His qualities either. We get angry and we lose our temper. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has anger. He has ghadab. But does He lose His temper? We get angry and we act on impulse. Does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala act on impulse? Everything for Him is calculated. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sometimes we get upset with someone, so we act unjustly with them. Will Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ever act unjustly with somebody? Never. Right? And the reason I bring this up is this. How many months between Ramadan and Dhul Hijjah? Two. Right? Two plus a couple of days. Because it's Ramadan, Shawwal, Dhul Qa'dah, and Dhul Hijjah. Right? So there's about 2 months and 2 months and 10 days, or 9 days, between Ramadan and the month of Dhul Hijjah. So imagine for a second that it is not God, but rather a human being that is in charge of the blessings of Ramadan. And you say to yourself, we will provide humanity with this beautiful season of forgiveness. We will open the doors for them to repent, for them to get closer to Allah. For them, you know, again, you're not the owner of the month of Ramadan, but you have been appointed by God to be the manager of the blessings in the month of Ramadan. And you are very excited about fulfilling your job, right? You know, the masajid are filled and available and clean and ready. The imams have prepared their Quran. The shayateen, all the devils have been shackled in chains. The doors and the gates of heaven are open. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ready to forgive our sins and to answer our dua. You know, the environment is ripe and ready. Some people throughout the month of Ramadan came to the masajid and they enjoyed the blessings of the masajid. But most people didn't. If you are the manager of those blessings as a human being, how would you react? You would probably say, you know what? I'm done with these people. I went out of my way to open the door for them, to invite them to God's blessings, to tell them that your sins will be forgiven, that you will be elevated, that your faith will get stronger, that your hearts will get cleaner, all of it, and they just ignore it. You know, that's why in the hadith, the Prophet says, what? خَابَ وَخَسِرْ مَنْ أَدْرَكَ رَمَضَانَ وَلَمْ يُغْفَرْ لَهُ. You will fail and lose if you witness the month of Ramadan and you are not forgiven. Right? But you know what? Thankfully, it is not a human being that is in charge of Ramadan's blessings. It is not a human being that is in charge of any blessings. In fact, it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Himself that is in charge of the blessings. What does the Creator do? After giving you the month of Ramadan with all of its doors and blessings and opportunities and forgiveness and afu and maghfirah and everything, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows that many people just ignored the month of Ramadan. What does He do? Act spitefully and condemn you for the rest of the year? No. 2 months later, He provides you with another season of love and grace and forgiveness. And He opens the door for you. And He marks that season by this massive, inescapable display of worship that is Hajj. Millions of people go, and the footage is on social media, the internet, even the CNN talks about it. It's in your face all over, in order to give you another reminder. In order to tell you, I have not given up on you. If you've missed the month of Ramadan, you can still catch the train in the month of Dhul Hijjah. If you've lost the opportunity of Ramadan, here's another opportunity. Only a loving, caring Creator would behave like this. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when we say, لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ, we need to teach our children that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves His creation. His love is not like our love, because it is not conditional. It is not bound. It is not incumbent upon anything. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you to enter Jannah. So one opportunity after the other He provides for you. One season of forgiveness and blessings after the other He provides for you. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. I ask Allah for every single one of us to be included and encompassed by the blessings of Allah Azza wa Jal. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on this beautiful day to bring awareness and enlightenment to our hearts and to make us among those who observe the blessings of this beautiful month of Dhul Hijjah. Brothers and sisters, raise your hands and speak to Allah Azza wa Jal from the heart. أدعو الله وأنتم موقنون بالإجابة. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعين به ونستهديه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فهو المهتد ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. وأصلي وأسلم على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين وقائد الغر الميامين محمد الصادق الوعد الأمين. اللهم صلي وسلم وزد وبارك على محمد وآله وأصحابه أجمعين، ورضى اللهم عنا معهم بفضلك وكرمك أرحم الراحمين. اللهم آمين. My dear brothers and sisters, as the month of Dhul Hijjah started its beautiful days, I wanted to keep myself reminded, but also remind you of the blessings of these days, very, very, very similar to the blessings of Ramadan. But yet the Prophet ﷺ says that the days of Dhul Hijjah, the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah, are the most blessed days of the year. And I wanted to tell you why today. And I showed you the qualities that are shared between Ramadan and Dhul Hijjah. And I said that Dhul Hijjah stands out because it is a sacred month. It's one of the Ashur al-Hurum compared to Ramadan, which is not. And I said that in the days of Eid al-Adha are actually longer than the days of Eid al-Fitr. It's 4 days compared to three. And the fact, and this is in my opinion the most important qualification, Dhul Hijjah bears this beautiful public display of worship, and that is the journey of Hajj, which we cannot experience in Ramadan. And all of that makes the month of Dhul Hijjah stand out. And I want to appeal to your sensibilities. I want to appeal to your modern and Western sensibilities, if I could, right? Because we live in an age where people are always looking out for opportunities. You're looking for opportunities to lower your rent, to lower your mortgage. You're looking for an opportunity to lower your bills, right? You know, I'm sure that you, like me, constantly call your internet provider and threaten them to discontinue the service if they don't give you a discount, right? We are always looking for opportunities to save. We're always looking for opportunities to make more money, right? If I told you there's a guaranteed business opportunity that will bring you this percentage of return, most people are just going to jump on it right away. If there is a clearance sale, people are standing in line in order to buy something. Maybe they don't even need it, but they stand in line in order to buy something because it is discounted. You go to the mall, you know, buy one, get one free. You will do that even though you don't need the extra item. But hey, you know, buy one, get one free. You know, who can say no to that? What I wanted to say is that we apply this to every aspect of our lives. Why not apply this to our religious experience as well? If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaches you that everything is multiplied in these days, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, gives a different quality and a different attribute to your acts of worship in the 10 days of Hijjah, why not do the same? You are regularly praying, right? Pray in the month of Dhul Hijjah with the intention of getting more hasanat. You may give your charity throughout the year. Give more in the month of Dhul Hijjah because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward you more. You can actually build your record more effectively if you utilize the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah. And we need to talk to our loved ones and our children, our spouses about this, right? It's only 10 days. Ramadan is 30. This is only 10 days. They will pass like this. And we need to take advantage of it. You know, at least we're just getting started, inshallah ta'ala. You know, next Friday will be the 8th of Dhul Hijjah. So we have a chance to actually do something. So you have Monday and you have Thursday. You can fast on those 2 days. And then you can fast on Saturday, inshallah ta'ala, which is the 9th of Dhul Hijjah, the day of Arafah. Which, by the way, is a day that forgives the sins of a previous year and an upcoming year. Subhanallah. You fast the day of Arafah every year. All of your minor sins will be regularly, on a regular basis, deleted and removed from the record. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us every step of the way. What are some of the things that we can do? And let me conclude the khutbah with this, inshallah. In the beautiful days of Dhul Hijjah, right? From the sunnah, number one, to make dhikr to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Learn the art of mentioning Allah's name. particularly التهليل والتحميد والتكبير والتسبيح. What is that? To say لا إله إلا الله, الحمد لله, سبحان الله, and الله أكبر. As many times as we can. So, you know, you're driving your car, subhanallah, alhamdulillah, la ilaha illallah, wallahu akbar. Right? You're in the elevator, subhanallah, alhamdulillah, la ilaha illallah, wallahu akbar. If you don't memorize this, big tasbih, perhaps just use the takbirat of Eid. Right? Allahu akbar, Allahu akbar, Allahu akbar, la ilaha illallah. Allahu akbar, Allahu akbar, walillahi alhamd. This is the least you can do, right? Allah says in the Quran, لِيَشْهَدُوا مَنَافِعَ لَهُمْ وَيَذْكُرُوا اللَّهَ فِي أَيَّامٍ مَعْلُومَاتٍ عَلَى مَا رَزَقَهُمْ. When you experience the blessed days of Hajj, you remember the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you mention Allah's name in return, right? So the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah are a huge opportunity for us to learn the art of dhikr, the remembrance of Allah, the mentioning of Allah's name, right? Which many people don't practice. Number two, as I said earlier, acts of charity, acts of giving in this beautiful month with the intention of doing it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the month of Dhul Hijjah. Number three, fast, as I said earlier, a couple of days at least this month, if not, then at least the day of Arafah, you know, in the first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah, right? Number four, make sure that you are connected to the masajid, that you understand what your ummah is going through, what your community is going through. Participate in the programs, attend the events and the activities, right? Number five, and I said this last Friday, let us, brothers and sisters, make a huge unprecedented show of numbers and force on the day of Eid. Let us show the wider community the strength of Muslims in numbers and presence and commitment. And those of you who have noticed, our Eid numbers have increased drastically the last few years to the extent that the Jackson Sports Academy is not enough for us anymore. And we've all known that since last year, right? I'm hoping and praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that this upcoming Eid al-Adha will be the last time we pray there, inshallah. There is a team now that is working on possibly getting the Cal Expo for next year's Eid, inshallah. So this year, we're still at the same location, all right? Don't spread false information, and we don't want people to show up at the Cal Expo next weekend, all right? That's next year, hopefully, inshallah. We haven't confirmed anything yet. But my point is, our numbers have been steadily growing, and the number of people that are coming to Salatul Eid have been steadily rising, and let us, inshallah ta'ala, make a statement to our wider community. We'll make sure that there is heavy media presence, you know, on that day, inshallah. Let us, if you had any other plans, cancel them. It's going to be a Sunday. Invite your non-Muslim friends. Invite your non-Muslim neighbors. You know, our message is always a positive message that will be important and relevant to both Muslims and non-Muslims. But it is important, inshallah ta'ala. You know, as remember last Friday, I talked about fascism. It is important to fight bigotry by just showing the strength of the Muslim community and its sheer numbers. Sometimes that is the most effective statement you can make. So let us make a commitment, inshallah, on Sunday that we will bring as many people as possible to Salatul Eid at the Jackson Sports Academy. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive our sins, to establish us firmly and with strength on His path. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to keep our hearts inspired and enlightened. I ask Allah azza wa jal to make our hearts tender, to help us react positively to the Quran. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among those who find it easy to follow the commandments of the deen. I ask Allah to make us an inspiration in the lives of others and to help us make da'wah with a positive attitude to bring people's hearts and minds closer to the deen. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us raise our children against all odds in this society to become good Muslims and good citizens. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the strength to continue our commitment to the deen, to continue to pray on time, to continue to avoid things that are haram. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as we have done everything in our capacity in this dunya to serve Him and to bring people to His path, I ask Allah to gather all of us in the highest level of Jannah. Allahumma ameen.